My name's Carlos Contreras. I was born and raised in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I come from a family of two older brothers. I'm the youngest of three, our youngest of three sons. And we have a sister who passed away. So we were four, we're now three. We have a live-in grandmother. So we grew up as a pretty large family in a full house. Growing up wasn't always easy. I had two older brothers, so I got picked on a lot, got made fun of a lot. And so getting in trouble sometimes meant getting them in trouble. And so I was probably not the funnest little brother to have, but we got into a lot of trouble together. I was 17 years old when I got into competitive poetry, or slam poetry, if you will. But I wrote for many years before that. I wrote as a little kid all the time. I used to really like creative nonfiction, and short stories and things like that when I was a young kid. And then when I found poetry in high school and realized that it was like a competitive art form, it appealed to me because I was a jock in high school. I played three sports a year. And I showed up and read, and I got probably about halfway through my poem before I got so nervous that I had to start over. And that was kind of like, the acceptance of that moment was kind of what made sense to me too, though. Because like I said, I was a big athlete in high school, and failure on a football field, on a basketball court, on a track, doesn't always equate to being good at something or being accepted when it's all over. And poetry wasn't that way. It didn't go so well the first time around, and everybody in the crowd let it happen a second time around. So I knew that there was something there. I write about family. So I write about family, place, and identity. In 10 years, those are probably my three themes that have carried the majority of my writing along. And so that's why we're sitting where we're sitting. We're in my house, the house I grew up in, not the house I live in. Because this is kind of what built me, and it's who I write about. I work at Gordon Bernal Charter School. It's an interesting school, to say the least. It was a brainchild of Jerry Ortizi Pino, who's a senator, I believe, here in New Mexico. Jerry's an amazing person, does a lot of community work, and just over 5 years ago, I guess, we've been in business for 4 years, but it was an idea before it was an actuality. They saw this disparity between this education in New Mexico and the incarceration rates, and decided that, you know, with 65% of people sitting in a 3,200 person jail without a GED or diploma, that there was a problem. And the idea for Gordon Bernal Charter School was born. So now 4 years into the making, Gordon Bernal Charter School is a school that primarily caters to incarcerated adults. My classroom's a traveling classroom. I work at Gordon Bernal Charter School, of course, but I do other stuff. I do contract work at a couple other schools. So at Gordon Bernal, my day is kind of unpredictable in a lot of ways. I work at the public campus, I work at Fourth and Roma, so we cater to folks that are on community custody, probation, parole, or what they call off paper and are in no way associated with the justice system, just decided to come to our school. And so we're very much true to our charter school roots and provide like a very one-on-one setting. So most of my classes top out at like 12 to 15 students, which is pretty crazy and unheard of at the high school level in Albuquerque. But I'm a star is kind of like a personal mantra that I kind of held on to, because I used to do art on clothing when I was in college. And one of the first pair of jeans I ever did had that on it, and I thought it was kind of neat. And it stuck with me, and the reason it stuck with me is not because I believe myself to be like this amazing, wonderful person as far as like being a performer or a star in that sense, but it's because with all the work that I've done, I realized how much or how little kids seem to believe in themselves, and how little support sometimes youth have. And I thought really that everybody at one point or another in their life should be able to say that. And so the blog became like this mission to do exactly that. So right now, it hosts what's called Escritores de Esperanza, and it's Writers of Hope. Hope writers, however you want to interpret it or translate it. but it's a school I work at, a charter school. And so any kids that are working in my writing workshops right now that want to post their work to the internet, when they submit it to me, it goes up under that heading. It plays host to community events, a lot of events I host, video clips, anything, online submissions from people around the community, around the country. Really what it is just kind of a host spot for all things poetry, all things journalism and activism, music and hip hop. I do this thing right here for everyone who knows they can, but for some unspoken reason has chosen not to. They just gave me 3 minutes, y'all. I got you. This is for hip-hop heads stuffing aerosol dreams, among other things, into the overloaded pockets of backpacks. For 65-year-old queens thumbing rosary beads who just happen to be self-admitted pack rats. You're the reason why I fly the heart on my sleeve at half-staff, and the reason why I never paid attention in math class. This poem is for you. It's a first step in mad dash towards what? Nothing. Something angry and confused, beautiful and broken. So these are the dirty pages to an open notebook that no one's quoting. This is for the passed over chapters, for the bent bookmarks and dusty spines. This is for the countless minds rotting behind bars, lost in space and time. Not everybody has 3 minutes, so once in a while I don't mind sharing mine. Hi, I come on behalf of beggars who, when asking you for change, aren't looking for you to spare a dime. This is a poem for not-for-profit prophets pursuing progress and changing lives, broadcasting live from the belly of the beast tonight. On stage, you see a man who, when he can't eat or sleep, he writes for you. The mom short a 20 spot to get what little boy wants the day before Christmas Eve. For you, the strawberried face of a broken-nosed beauty who keeps telling herself to leave. And for you, the crying babies lying next to folded flags that the newly widowed wife just received last week, we hear you. We can relate to the unrest and the loss of stolen dreams between the seats. So every time I'm thrown 3 minutes, you're on the list of reasons why I speak my poems, eat, breathe, and sleep. The nails, teeth, and streets. And maybe if we relied more on things like these and relied less on wireless, we'd realize we already have access to the best frequencies and beats for free. Every minute of our lives. So I figured y'all wouldn't mind if ours were intertwined for three. You've been taken from so much that today, I offer you this part of me. So for this time taken out of your day, you can feel like nobody's forgot you. They just gave me 3 minutes, y'all. I got you.